Well, hello, good morning. I'm Mark, and I'm going to talk to you about a platform we've built at Trovit, which is a resilient real-time bidding platform. Hopefully, resilient. First, me, I studied here at this university. It's good to be here instead of down there for a change. After a career, I did some research on supercomputing. I also here in the Barcelona Supercomputing Center. And then I moved to London for a change. There I discovered Hadoop and all this kind of craziness about data science, data engineering, and so on. After 3 years, you know, with the weather, I came back. And I'm still working with the same stuff. I'm still working in Hadoop, and I'm still working with data science, right? I'm working here at Trovit. It's a classified search engine. These are just some numbers, so you more or less know what we're talking about. We have more or less 180 million ads. We have a cluster with Hadoop, recently a little bit of Spark as well, and we have 170 terabytes of data. 65 million uniques and 170 million visits per month. That's per month, I forgot to put it here. And everybody's moving to mobile, so we have 10 different apps that use our data, right? And we have a really cool office in Barcelona. If you like what I'm saying, just ping me, because we are hiring. The domain, real-time bidding. How many of you do you know what real-time bidding? Good enough. Okay, cool. Well, it's about selling ads. Big surprise. The thing is that we buy the ads per impression basis. So you don't buy 1,000 ads. You don't buy 1,000,000 ads for this kind of users. For each user, we get asked, like, do you want to show an ad to this user? So, of course, you need to do this via in a programmatic way. There's a program that needs to be done. What we get is what we call a bid request, which is something like, look, there's this user who's loading youtube.com, and in that part of the page, there is an ad slot this size. Do you want to put your ad in there? Yes or no? And yes, how much are you willing to pay? So we are playing here. There are lots of exchanges, but right now we are using only the Google one, which is, of course, the big one. These are the SLAs of Google. You need to respond yes or no under 100 milliseconds. This is taking into account the network time. So at the end, you have 50 milliseconds to make a decision, because, I mean, of course, you need to receive the packet, and then you need to send the packet, right? Right now we are around 5 milliseconds, so we are quite proud of it. We are really good, and we have just lots of room for improvement, but that's cool. Another of the SLAs is that if we screw up more than 50% of our responses, we get banned, right? Which is bad, which is really, really bad. 50% of bad responses means that you are either sending back rubbish, or you are taking too long to respond, right? And this is really, really, really bad. Currently, we are handling our peak is 10,000 QPS, which is queries per second. That's quite a lot, right? At least for our scale, and. Well, there, that's big time. That's about 7 different countries we are doing this. And in this talk, I'm going to talk you about how we maintain the system stable, right? We could be talking about lots of things. We could be talking about how we made the system fast. Mm-hmm. This is not my talk. This is Jordi's talk. Jordi, say hi. It's next talk. And I'm not talking about how we make the decisions. That's a machine learning problem. That I'm going to talk a little bit about it, but not in depth in this presentation. But so how do we maintain the system stable? This system is spending money. potentially 10,000 times every second, right? That you need to be really sure to before doing anything. This might seem a joke, but we are a really small team, and we really take care of what we do. We are passionate about the project, and we kind of code things carefully, thinking a lot about it, and a lot with tests. Until yesterday, I was quite proud of our test environment and how we manage tests. But I don't know if you went to the LMAX guys talk. Are the LMAX guys here? Thanks, mate. We are a bunch of amateurs. So, still, shit happens, right? You can code things carefully, but there's always some remote scam that gets into your stuff and blows the main generator. So enter resiliency. Resiliency it's a word that the definition could be the ability to recover from expected errors. That's quite a bold sentence. To recover means that you need to do something before everything goes down, right? So you need to detect that there's something wrong, and you need to react. And from unexpected errors, I would like to say that an error is different than a failure. An error is something that will happen. There are always errors, right? The database goes down, the network goes down. Those are errors. A failure is when you cannot comply to the system SLA. And failure for us is not being able to respond in under 100 milliseconds and respond rubbish more than 15% of the time. But also, it's something that lets us sleep well at night. In this talk also, I'm going to talk a little bit about patterns. You'll see that there are lots of different patterns, and I will talk a little bit how we got those patterns into our system, right? This is our architecture. If you've seen a real-time bidding architecture, I guess this is not a surprise. It's quite a typical thing. We have a load balancer in front of everything that gets load, distributes it among, right now we have 14 bidders. A bidder, it's just machine. The red boxes are our code. The green boxes are third-party things that should not break, right? The thing is that we have 10 machines bidding in Barcelona, in a data center here, and 4 machines in the United States, because we are serving also traffic from South America. And what happened is that when we got the request, it was already past 100 milliseconds. So we had to, of course, bring the machines there. More or less, the bidder is quite dumb. It's fast, but dumb. It doesn't make many decisions. All the decisions are already taken and are stored in Redis, right? We have the Redis inside the same machine, so there's no network connection there. It's really, really fast, and it's what we need. Everything that happens, memory usage, blah, 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 it's collected in Netty and centralized, which is used in our monitoring system, right? Then all the interesting information about we got this bid request, but we didn't bid because we thought that something. We did that request and we won. We did that request, but we lost. All this information goes into Kafka. There's a shitload of data in there. That data gets stored inside the raw data, and then we have the stats. The stats package is something. It's basically a bunch of MapReduce jobs and Hive jobs that read the raw data, clean it, collect it, does different stuff. And then it stores it again in Hadoop for further processing and in MySQL. This aggregated data in MySQL is then used in the web interface, so we can see what's going on in a more decent way, right? Then I think the last step is the backend. Our backend is another bunch of MapReduce jobs with some machine learning algorithms implemented. So these are the algorithms that get the raw data and take the decisions, like we are going to bid for this kind of users, but not for those kind of users. And we are willing to pay this amount of money for these users, but not for the other users, right? This is the data that then gets sent into each of the local Redis in the different meters, right? In two different data centers. So as you see, this is a distributed system, and let's think about what could go wrong here. So lots of things. I don't know if you've read that paper or that blog post, I can't remember. It's called the 9 fallacies of distributed computing, which is basically telling you that everything that can go wrong will eventually go wrong. There are so many things up here that our code can blow up. Our connection to anything, all the integrations could blow up. For example, we could be sending bad data to Hadoop. The Hadoop job will run, but the data will be wrong. So we will be taking wrong decisions, right? So we need to be ready for that, for those errors. Let's have a little bit of fun, just for a minute, because I want to talk to you about the kind of, at least for me, the worst kind of failure, which is the cascading failure. So for example, let's imagine that in the peak hour, all our meters are 100% below its total, right? So what happens is, for any reason, this Redis fails. If this Redis fails, the bidder won't be able to take decisions. If it's not coded correctly, the bidder will go nuts. It will start giving timeouts. The load balancer will realize that this bidder is not working properly, so it will discard this bidder and will put the load in other bidders. Those bidders are already 100%. The bidders will start failing. In 5 minutes, because this happened in 5 minutes, you'll see all your infrastructure completely down, and then to discover what happened in the beginning, it's a real pain. So at least for me, that's the worst thing that could happen, a really small thing in one machine that brings down the entire system. When we talk about a resilient system, these are the things that you need to do. Not exactly in this order, because recovery and warning could be kind of paralyzed, but of course, you need to detect that there is an error. You need to detect that something is really, really wrong, recover from it, and then warn, and, you know, time to panic, start sending emails and things. How you do that, of course? Monitoring resiliency patterns, I'm going to talk about them now, and notifications. Everybody choose the better notifications. But first of all, monitoring. I don't know if anyone not from Barcelona, but that's real, right? I haven't made it up. There's a square in Barcelona called George Orwell, and there are cameras. Yeah. how do you monitor your systems? There are some tools, but a fairly typical pattern I've seen is this one, using logging, right? So this is a typical log configuration. If there is there's a threshold, so if there is a log error, you print it on your screen, but you also send an email to the tech and the CEO and with a sensible subject. And everybody gets the email, everybody gets to the computer and solves the issue. But this is going to give you problems if the kind of errors you've got are out of memory exceptions, right? What happens here is that your system will be probably in the garbage collector, or it will have run out of memory, which means that when you try to use this, the logger will try to create an object. It won't be able to create the object because it has no memory. The system will fail, and no mails are sent anywhere, right? So how can we prevent that? Bear with me, please. I don't get enough sleep, usually. I want to talk about it. So, out of memory, right? These are fairly common exceptions in Java. If you are doing this to monitor that your process is running, this is good. Change Java for the name of your application or whatever. This will work. Same as the logger until you get out of memory exceptions or some kind of out of memory exceptions. This is why that's parameter. The process will not die. The process will be there completely frozen. So it's not no estaba muerto, estaba de parranda. For the English speakers, there is a song for this guy who says, I'm not dead, I was just partying, right? So that's what happens to the process when it has out-of-memory exceptions. So something that we discovered with these issues is that there's this really cool JVM configuration option. I don't know, how many of you did you know it? Maybe it was the only one. Okay. This what happens is that when the virtual machine detects that there's an out-of-memory exception of any kind, out-of-memory, the garbage collector going nuts, whatever, it forks the process and it executes something. So in that something, it starts a new JVM if required. It's a shell script. You can do anything here. So when we detect that there's an out-of-memory exception, in this case, we are using the Slack REST to send, hey, this machine has run out of memory, right? So, a little bit more about out of memory. I mean, when these things happen, everybody knows how to deal with out of memory exceptions. Like, okay, let's release the objects. There are lots of different things. I discovered these ones recently. I haven't had time to experiment with them at that, but they are really, really promising. I took this one from a talk about high frequency trading, is that the objects in Java, they are really, really big, right? But they could be much, much smaller. So what you are doing here, instead of having a typical Java bin with integer, double, double, and string, you could have just a byte array, and then you know that from position 0 to 32, that's an integer. From position 33 to whatever, that's the next integer, right? This is a pain in the ass to program. This is really a pain in the ass. But then if you compare the size of these objects, it makes a huge difference, and it makes a huge impact in the garbage collecting process, right? Also, the next one is the parallel memory conditions. There is a class in the JVM. It's called reference and soft reference. So these classes, the first ones that get garbage collector. So if you, for example, have a really big object, but there's a part which is kind of optional. It's good to have, but if you don't have it, the system will be able to run it again. So just drop this kind of optional thing into the soft reference class, and then when the garbage collector starts going nuts because I'm running out of memory, those optional things will be the first ones to go away, right? So these are kind of experimental things, but could help you in this kind of situation. Backup logging, the next technique, it's a habit. That's fairly simple, but it's really easy to do wrong, right? For more or less the same thing that the previous logger, that the process might be hanged or really hanged, but can still respond to some kind of ping. So maybe if your system has a REST interface that it's only in charge to say, I'm alive, maybe the process is burning, but that interface is still working, right? So you think that system is alive and well, but it's dying underneath. So in Hadoop, what you need to do is do some real work. It's that's kind of good. That's logical, but sometimes you see stuff and people don't do it. In a database, do a select. Don't check that the process is alive. Do a select. Do a join. If you know that this user needs to exist in a database, use that. If you need that our system must respond, I want bit to this user, do a bit, a false bit with that user to check that the system is really, really working, right? And just another pattern, there are lots more, but these are my favorites. The supervision with actors. In case you are using Aka, this is really easy to do. This comes from Merlin and OTP. The nice thing about this is that you have some specialized code that is really looking after the other parts of your code. So there's someone in charge to check that everything is working fine. And the nice thing here is that you have the control flow and you have the data flow. Data flow is your program, but you have the control flow that checks that the rest of the program is really working. This is hard to do if you are not using an actor framework. This is really to do if you are using an actor framework. So if you're using an actor framework, this is the way to go. In our case, we have a little bit of everything. We have those tricks I showed you before, and well, we have nuggets because we still want to know if there's the Java process running, of course. The logging, we are not sending the mails directly, we're sending them to Sentry, the Sentry or Workstash, whatever. We have heartbeats with real work, and we have graphite competitions. So we log everything to graphite, we have data there, and we have some programs that read the data. So if we know that yesterday at this time we had 7,000 requests per second, and now today at the same time we have one request per second, that's a huge difference. That's something probably wrong. We coded these ones ourselves, and we used a framework called Spock. Does anybody know the Spock testing framework in Ruby? Not enough people. So probably all of you use unit tests, hopefully, and these are kind of hard to code sometimes. There's this framework, it's called Spock, it's completely integrated with all the IDEs, and you write your tests in Ruby, which is awesome because it lets you do everything much, much, much simpler than with unit tests. It's really easy to integrate in everything. You can test in Scala code, in Java code, it's amazing. So once you start using Spock for your unit tests, you won't be able to go back to unit. And the last thing, have graphs, graph everything. This is one screenshot of our web interface. This is Cubism. It's a JavaScript library made by the guys at Square, I think. And it lets you plot these time series, right? And frequencies. So right now we have 6.7k requests per second, queries per second, some of the percentages we are using. And of course, this is really helpful when you deploy new code, right? Because this is live. So you can see 5 seconds after you've deployed your code if there are really weird spikes or things like this. So this is really, really helpful to have, right? It's real time feedback of your system. Okay, now we know that something might be wrong somewhere in the system, no? And we need to recover. We need to do something about that. In our case, we data-intensive systems like this one, what we have is two kind of failures. We have bad data problems, that the data is corrupt, and then we have the errors in the system, which is your typical null-pointer exception somewhere. Let's talk about the data errors. How to recover from those? Well, it's not rocket science. Just roll back to something that worked. When possible, of course. If your database is big enough, you can maintain several versions of your data and keep the old version around. So if you detected your new data is wrong, just switch to the old one. This is stupidly simple, but there's something here. Know how to do a rollback, because so many times I found like, okay, now we have everything implemented, but then at 5 a.m. when everything's burning, nobody knows how to do a proper rollback and the situation gets worse. Lots of people have said it in this conference already, but I'm going to say it again. These kind of things, try them in production, try them in your test environment, test all the recoveries, because you will eventually need to do that. Again, at 5 a.m. I'm a little bit ashamed of having to put these, but check everything. And I'm ashamed because this happened to me. And we had a really weird error. It was, I swear, there are people here who can say it's true. Christmas dinner party in the office, right? We started selling, receiving emails from Google telling us our, we were bidding at 9 trillion euros. Like, of course, we won all of those. The nice thing is that in these kind of systems, when you do a bid, so okay, I'm willing to pay 9 trillion euros, but what you really pay is the second price. So what happened here is we were willing to pay 9 trillion euros, the next guy was willing to pay 2 cents, and we only got the bill for 2 cents, right? But this could have been really, really, of course, we collected that with this, just check state. This is from Google Lava. These are really nice and convenient methods. You just give it the condition, and this will send the exception, illegal state, illegal argument, whatever it is. It's really easy to do. Be really paranoid with this. It will, you know, it will eventually help. System errors, these are my favorite ones. These happen in the iterations. So your code might blow up or not, that's one thing. But the problems start arising when you are working with different systems. So your code, when you start using a database, God knows what can happen, right? 99% of the times you know what will happen. Part of libraries, choose anything that it's not your code, can blow up. If there are network connections in the middle, it more chances to blow up, right? Databases are necessary super delays. It can happen anything in a database, right? Anything. You can lose the connection. That's a typical error. You can have timeouts. What you are doing with the timeout? If your code is completely synchronous, you are fucked up. Can give you corrupted data. This is the worst thing that could happen. So if data is corrupted, some checks after a query to the database might help. Can give you zero data, so empty response. Let's be serious. How you check that what you get from the database is empty? Something. And another thing is that it can give you too much data. It also happened that happened to me again. I was confident that the table would be always hundreds of rows big, but suddenly one day somebody put lots of things in that date in the table, and then several hundred thousands rows. So I did a select star, put that into a list, and the list blew up. Also, if you think that your table needs to have only hundreds of elements, check that really only has hundreds of elements. If not, that might be a problem. Just scream and panic mode. The patterns to solve these timeouts, lost connections, are really simple. It's circuit breaker and bulkhead pattern. I'm going to explain them, but in a kind of really, really fast and simple way, because they are not really hard to understand. This is a circuit breaker. I guess everybody knows how this thing works, right? It's an electrical element that prevents your house from burning down when there's an electrical element. What happens here? That when there's a problem, you get no electricity in your house, which is probably much better than not having your house completely burned down. Good news for JVM users. The guys at Netflix, they implemented this, which is called Itstrix. Anybody know this? Oh dear. It's basically these patterns already implemented, right? So and also they did them for taking into account a microservices architecture. So lots of connections to different systems. What this pattern does is that when there's a timeout, when there is an error, what you are doing is you are opening your circuit. Like, so the next time anybody tries to use the database, it will find that the circuit breaker is open. What will happen that, I mean, you are not using the database because the circuit breaker doesn't let you. The only interesting thing about this is that you are forced, if you're using this pattern while calling your application, you are forced to think about what will happen if you cannot access your database, right? So it's not just throwing an exception and that somebody will handle it. This is a failure because probably your system will blow up. But if you know that you are trying to use a database because you really need to use a database, but you cannot use a database, then you need to do something. The exception you need to launch, or the way you need to handle this, is throwing an error, whatever the domain is, but the system will be still complying with SLAs. In our case, that's an example. Those are single makers. We only have two, but one is called in Java, the other one it's not called at all. But the thing is that here, when the builder tries to access Redis, if Redis is down, you cannot give a timeout. Because if you are giving timeouts, what will happen is that the builder will give timeouts, the load balancer will get crazy, will start sending stuff to other builders. Maybe that's not the optimal solution. So when we are finding that something is down, we say, not bid. I'm not bidding for this bid request. Is bad, yes, it is bad, we are not paying for this request, but we are still complying with SLAs. We are still responding in time, and we are still responding proper request. Which is, no bid, it's a completely valid request. If you are not bidding anything at all for a period of time, that's completely fine, no problem. And the other one is the load balancer. If the load balancer sees that everything is going nuts, the load balancer itself is coded, so it will send, I'm not bidding anything. So two circuit breakers. In our case, it's really, really simple. It's really simple to comply these SLAs. Something wrong, I'm not bidding, sorry, next one. That's the bulkhead pattern, that's the one I told you. It's completely tied with a circuit breaker. Bulkhead pattern, it's coding your application in such a way that if a part of the application is not working, the rest of the application is working. Maybe not right, but the application is still there and is still complying with SLAs. It's exactly what I told you. If we have no Redis, we cannot take decisions. The only thing we can do is we are doing an update. The bulkheads are just these compartments in the ships that if there is a hole in one, water gets inside, but the other keep the boat sailing, right? Finally, this is the schema for Titanic. This one didn't work fine. So when you have the circuit breaker open, of course, also really simple, but just checklist things you need to do. Yeah, when you have a circuit breaker open, time to panic, start screaming. Somebody probably needs to have a look at something. Also, something you can do is try again. Maybe there was a network connection, but after half a second, the network is up again. Something like that. Try again, but do it in a sensible way. You don't want to do a DOS attack at your own database. So there's an exponential retry, like I'm trying now. It doesn't work. Okay, let's wait 1 second. If it doesn't work, let's wait 10 seconds and then 100 seconds. This will keep your system retrying without hitting the database too hard. Other things you can do is do a failover, like if you have a database backup, you just use the other database. Or in case of extreme case, just your system might risk out something. This is my last slide. It's left some bits and pieces that didn't fit well in other parts of the talk. This is the thing about tight coupling, at least to fast propagation of errors, is what they said. If you have a synchronous call to a database and the database is giving you a timeout, there's not much you can do to prevent the error blowing up the code. But if you are using a synchronous future, for example, to check, to use the database, in the synchronous code you can set a timeout. So if you're not responding in 5 seconds, you open the circuit breaker, right? So tight coupling it's hard to apply these patterns in a tight coupled monolith, for example. And something really helpful with that is event-driven development. Google Weather, for example, yet again, has a really nice tool to, you know, it has an event bus, so you can send events, you can respond to these events, and it's really, the circuit breaker and the bucket pattern really fit well into here. Complete parameter checking, single points of failure, of course, forbidden. In our case, I mean, we have one, we have the load balancer. If the load balancer goes down, we are nuts, but we are working on it. A stateless is better, always. And again, what happened with select star and let the database return anything, bound things, or otherwise you'll start having out of memory exceptions, which I showed you back at hard to control. This is everything. I just would like to finish saying that errors happen, and whatever things you do, they will happen. They will hit your system in a completely unexpected ways. So be ready for everything if you are dealing with systems that need to be alive and well. That's it. If you have any questions, I'll be free to happy to answer them. Any kind of discussion afterwards.
Mentioned out of memory errors causing issues. Do you have problems with garbage collection pauses?
Yeah.
Does it meet your SLA?
Yes. So, is that the question?
Yeah.
Sorry, I didn't understand that.
And what kind of things do we have to do to combat that?
We have an inherent problem. It's when there are too many connections, we have too many open ports, there are some timeouts, circuit breaker opens, but the connections, that's kind of a Netty issue, that the connections, sockets are not closed, they start filling memory. It's in fact what happened when we had that much load, that the exceptions, the out-of-memory exceptions, were because we had too many open ports, too many open connections, and the garbage collector couldn't handle that. So we got out of memory exception, but that exception that the garbage collector took 98% of its time trying to collect something, blah, blah, blah. And the problem completely froze. Other than that, this was by far the biggest problem we had with this out of memory.
Yes.
I will give you the name of the guy who made the whole presentation about that. But the thing is that an integer in Java should be 32 bytes, right? Yeah, 32 bytes. 4 bytes. But if you are using the integer object, it's not 4 bytes. It's 4 bytes because it has. So it has everything in there, right? So it's really easy to have a really big Java bin, which only contains two integers and two doubles, right? So, but what you really only need the numerical values of those guys. So and you really need that for storing an integer, you need just 4 bytes, not whatever amount of bytes JVM is using for the big object. So. You get the numerical value, convert it to int, and you know that those are 4 bytes, right? You put that into the byte array, but it's your byte array. You know how this is constructed. So the first 4 bytes, that's the first int. The next 4 bytes, it's another int, right? That's, instead of being two Java objects, it's just an 8-byte array. So when you need to write or you need to read those values from the Java, what you're doing is instead of get first value returns first value, you need to go to the byte array, read the four first bytes, construct the integer, that's the integer you get. But the thing is that, for example, you still create objects, because every time you deserialize this object. But the interesting thing is that when you store these objects in a hash map, for example, or in a list, those objects are much, much, much smaller. The tests I made is I tried to fit a Java bean lots of times into a list with just an amount of memory. I will make up the numbers, but I could fit, for example, 1,000 Java beans into the list. But if I serialize those the same objects using the byte array instead of using the Java objects, I could fit only three times that many objects into the list. So the object is smaller. You still create and destroy objects, but if you are storing huge lists, that's an improvement. Yeah, there's a presentation. I'll give you the name of the guy who made the presentation. It was at KubeCon London last conference, and it was something about the high frequency training. I'll give you the details.
Hi. Why didn't you use Hystrix in every point of failure?
We really tried to use Hystrix because it's a really cool project. But the way the Netflix guys call it Hystrix, it's more thought about. Lots of different connections to different systems. No? Right. So, in our case, the natural point was using Hystrix was just the bidder, which does just a local connection to Redis. It's always that connection. So what happened here is that in Hystrix, the circuit breaker opened when, I can't remember the details now, but you cannot really control who's opening. Exactly, okay. But in our case, we really needed to control who opens and who closes the circuit breaker. So our approach was, okay, let's, you know, we were talking to the mailing list and everything, and what we needed to do was just fork Hystrix, do the patch, submit back, blah, blah, blah. That's something we could do, but back then it was much, much, much easier to get. We are using Jellies to connect to Redis. It was much easier to create our own commands, which are based in Hystrix commands, and made them our way. Back then it was much, much simpler than that.
The
Spot jobs are executed. We have a continuous integration system. We have Jenkins. Jenkins is in charge of doing the builds, doing some of the deployments. And using Spot, we have a basically a project which are only tests. We have lots of Spot tests, but those are really easy to implement. You can anything in the test, of course. So what we are doing is every 5 minutes, I think it is, that the Spock test suit runs entirely. And for example, we have, okay, for each of the bidders, you query into the database and check that we are using subscription in Redis, and we always know that there are n connections alive. If there are less than n connections, that's the test failing. If the test suit is failing, means that at least one of the tests, did not succeed. There's something wrong. It's really easy to build. Yeah. Well, thank you everyone for listening.